Now, as the curator of education at the National World War I Museum Memorial, it's been a real delight since 2013 to be commemorating and to be bringing focus on a history in conjunction with the United States World War I Centennial Commission. What you just saw was a picture from our digitized archive, which is located on our website, theworldwar.org. And this is just one of a multitude of beautiful images from our April centennial event with the commission commemorating the U.S. entry into World War I. That is just one of many partnerships that we have with the commission. I'll tell you more about those, particularly the education focused ones, especially if you're a teacher and you are joining us on this chat. I really look forward to telling you about some online resources with which we partner, or your two national World War I memorials partner together to provide you who are on the front lines of education right now. So at the end of our conversation, I'll be sure to share some more information about that. Also, a nice thing about an online event like this one, you can absolutely, and you should, be multitasking. Take a look right there. That is the World War I Centennial Commission's website, www.cc.org. And I believe that Edwin's going to be sharing a little bit more about some of the ways that you can learn more about that memorial. And please, we would invite you to learn more about the National World War I Museum and Memorial. This is a picture from its opening in 1926, when then President Calvin Coolidge spoke to the largest crowd any president had spoken to up until that date. And we have been open since June, but if you're not in the greater Kansas City region, we would invite you to go across what would be that main entrance bridge to the main gallery to visit us online at theworldwar.org/online. And what we're gonna kick off is actually with this. Since I would like to say 1926, but our mission of this museum memorial, which has been around since 1926, it is to be the only museum in the United States dedicated to remembering, interpreting, and understanding the Great War and its enduring impact on the global community. Now, to our conversation at hand. Edwin Fountain is currently General Counsel for the American Battle Monuments Commission, also known as you might hear it in our conversation as the ABMC, who has for over a decade been a visionary leader to bring a national memorial to Washington, D.C. to honor the sacrifices of Americans in World War I. Among others, such as Congressman Emanuel Cleaver and Congressman Ted Poe, he fought for the legislation that produced the National World War I Centennial Commission and acted as vice chair of the commission until 2019 and continues today in spearheading significant and tangible memorialization within and for the United States. Dr. Matthew Naylor is the president and CEO of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and he has led the organization to unprecedented success in breaking records in attendance, programming, and media platforms since he took the helm in 2013. He is a global and national leader in the memorialization of World War I, creating a national traveling exhibition that toured around the United Kingdom, bringing together leaders from several continents in considering and commemorating the First World War. And he is a commissioner on the United States World War I Centennial Commission. Edwin, Matt, thank you both so much for joining us for this lunch and learn conversation about World War I memorials and what is happening right now in Kansas City and what's happening in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Laura. Great to be with you. Good to see you, Edwin.
Good to see you, Matt, as always.
Now, Edwin, I mentioned that you are working for the ABMC. Could you tell us more about the work of that particular commission?
Certainly, and ABMC is our mission is almost as old as yours. We were chartered in 1923 by Congress, and given at that time the mission of establishing monuments throughout the American battlefields of Europe after the Great War to commemorate and honor the service and achievements of American armed forces in World War I. Our first chairman was General John Pershing. who had been, of course, commander of the American Expeditionary Forces in the war. Interestingly, one of his early assistants on the commission was a fellow named Dwight Eisenhower, who did a lot of the, who helped write the our guide to American battlefields in Europe, and that work proved to be of use to him in World War II. And then, of course, our next chairman after Pershing was George Marshall, who has World War I connections. So we, the commission erected ultimately eight, I believe, memorials across France. And then in 1933, and we also designed the chapels that were established at the permanent American cemeteries in Europe. And then in 1933, President Roosevelt transferred those cemeteries to us. And so our brand now, if you will, is really our cemeteries. Most people are familiar with the Normandy Cemetery from World War II being our best known one. But that was part of the larger World War I commemorative program after the war in this country and abroad. ABMC's focus was very much on leading the establishment of American memorials overseas. Back here, we had primarily a focus on state and local memorials. We didn't have a national memorial at the time in Washington, at least, like we think of today when we think of the Vietnam Memorial, the World War II Memorial. And it's to the credit of the good citizens of Kansas City that they took it upon themselves to erect something like a national World War I Memorial there. And we've been pleased to partner with them over the last several years.
And I will personally say it's a tremendous honor to help lead some of the battlefield tours with the National World War I Museum Memorial to the ABMC-led memorials on the Western Front. And we look forward to that continued partnership when we are able to travel again. Now, you set us up really well. Matt, could you speak a bit more to the history of the National World War I Museum and Memorial and how it started so early?
Yeah, you bet. It seems to me that the U.S. Response to memorialization is fundamentally different than other places around the world. Whereas in Australia, where I grew up, in the Commonwealth countries, in many European countries, it's a top-down legislative action that funds and establishes a memorial. Whereas in the United States, there is a reliance upon people being engaged in the civic space. And so that's the story of the National World War I Museum and Memorial. Soon after the armistice in 1918, a group of community leaders came together saying, how can we memorialize the war dead of the region and create a tribute for peace? No doubt because Pershing was from Missouri, that would have played into that. But many cities, many towns across the country were thinking about how might they memorialize their war dead. And of course, you know, that's every small town and village in France and even small town and villages in Australia. That's the case as well. But then in 1919, a remarkable thing happened, I think. The crowdsourced funding, 83,000 people in a community of about 250,000 participated in a fundraising campaign, raised $2.5 million, the equivalent today of close to $40 million in 10 days. It was a 7-day campaign, but they extended it to 10 to reach their target. And then, and that then was the funding to create the memorial. Five Allied commanders from Belgium, Italy, France, the UK, and US came in 1921 to dedicate this location. And then the memorial was built and opened in 26, as Laura said, to Coolidge coming as president. He came in as vice president in 21, came back as president in 26. So it really represents for me the very essence of the American participatory democracy. People gather around causes that matter. And there were many memorials established across the US. This one is at scale. And also the founders established a museum at the time. So began collecting in 1920 and chose at that time to collect from all of the countries, which further differentiates this work. And if needs be, I can make comment about that later on. And then more recently, it's undertaken a massive renewal, more than $100 million raised by locals in the late 80s, early 90s, when some deferred maintenance caught up with the facility. In the late 80s, early 90s was when the deferred maintenance caught up fundraising late 90s, early 2000s, new museum established, and a renovated memorial, which is what you see in the picture there. So a wonderful story, I think, of you know, Midwest grassroots fundraising and ingenuity.
Well, one thing that's always struck me about the Liberty Memorial there, Matt, is that it's just up the hill from Union Station in Kansas City, which, of course, so many doughboys traveled through coming from the West on their way to the East Coast training camps and ports and whatnot.
Yeah, it was second busiest railroad for many, many years in the U.S. And indeed, you know, really the crossroads of the railroads that came in from various places in the country. And then for, particularly in the Second World War, for those servicemen and women leaving or coming home to then see this tribute speaks to something also of the values which are sought to be articulated in the memorial about honoring those who choose to serve or who have to serve, that that's then in physical form articulated. And of course, as you say, Edwin, for people to see that as they're leaving or coming back, I think is full of rich symbolism.
So Edwin, that's a really good question that you ask. Could you expand, especially that you have been working on memorials that cross so many eras? Could you expand on the purpose of a memorial?
Certainly, and you've touched on an interesting aspect of it when you talk about memorials across a variety of eras. And I think the purpose of a memorial, I mean, ultimately the purposes are all the same, but they vary depending on when the memorial is erected relative to the time it's commemorating. The purpose, it depends on the time when a viewer looks at the memorial relative to the events. And it's relative to the location and ultimately to the elements of the memorial. And so all those factors emphasize one purpose or another, but Matt got it at one of them just a moment ago. I mean, ultimately and initially is just the intrinsic purpose of honoring those who served. And for a memorial like the Liberty Memorial in Kansas City, which was erected contemporaneously, the veterans of that war could see that and know that they were being honored by their fellow citizens. And when we built the Vietnam Veterans, when the nation built the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington, in the immediate aftermath of that war, that was very consciously intended to honor those living veterans as they returned home from their, or soon after they returned home from their service. That value continues over time, even as those veterans begin to pass on. When we took on the National World War I Memorial in Washington, of course, there were no more American veterans of World War I. Frank Buckles, the last American veteran, died 2 years before the commission was formed. And so at that point, that intrinsic value of honoring the veterans, honoring those who served, is a little more inchoate because they aren't here to acknowledge that, to feel that recognition. And so in a way, in a very spiritual sense, we are doing it for them, but we're really doing it for ourselves. It is an act directed toward ourselves whereby we honor and remember them. And that leads to the other two main purposes I see in memorials. One is very much an educational purpose. Memorials can be more or less didactic. Obviously, in Kansas City, you have the museum right there, so there's a very incredibly strong educational component. But the memorials in Washington tend not to have strong educational components. They teach at a very broad level and then hopefully inspire further education. At the World War I Memorial, which we'll look at shortly, we recognize that this was a war that many Americans did not know very much about, particularly relative to the later wars of the 20th century or earlier wars like the Civil War or the American Revolution. And so we have incorporated a lot of overt educational material in the memorial beyond just the imagery. And then the third purpose is, and I've reflected on this a lot in the last few years, is a memorial and what a nation chooses to honor from its past and how it chooses to honor it, to my mind, and the value I find in it, is really an effort to instill and inculcate a, inculcate a common history and a common heritage and a common set of values that all the nation citizens, regardless of their political beliefs or whatnot, can come around and share as Americans. And so no matter what our, you know, whether we're immigrants or whether our families have been here for centuries, whether we're left, whether we're right, whatever our demographic characteristics, we should still be able to go to a place like the National World War I Museum and Memorial in Kansas City or the Memorial in Washington and appreciate something about what it is to be an American and what it is in our history that ought to make us all proud as Americans. And I think that's of inestimable value.
Absolutely. And I appreciate the comment that you made just about how in different eras things shift. At the National World War I Museum Memorial, we have one particular inscription on the base of the tower, dedicating it in honor to those who served in defense of liberty and our nation. And then another inscription is on our Great Freeze, which was added a decade later, that actually faces that Union Station that was talked about earlier, that says, do all that can ensure a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Which has a little bit of a different feel to it, and also speaks, Edwin, to what you are talking about for this present day, in part of creating that lasting peace among ourselves, making sure that people can see themselves in those spaces. Matt, you have the challenge of leading an organization that is both a memorial and a museum. Are there particular challenges to being both?
Yeah, so, you know, Edwin pointed to the challenge of a memorial in the nation's capital, and you know, this is a wrong which has been righted in large measure by the energy that Edwin and then others come in around that cause, that this is the only conflict of the 20th century of this scale which is not honored with a memorial in the nation's capital. Now, there's a DC memorial, but there's no national memorial until now. That itself is a fascinating question there. It certainly speaks to the place that World War I has in the narrative, in the popular narrative in the United States, which it doesn't occupy a dominant place in the narrative. It seems to me it's overshadowed by the Civil War and World War II, which are perhaps easier to understand, they're cleaner. World War I's complicated, it involves empires that don't exist anymore, and so forth. So we have an interesting challenge. One of the things that memorials do is allow people to gather together, whether that be as a group or themselves, for the purpose of reflection and to be drawn to ask questions. We instituted a very simple ceremony to help facilitate this, which gets to your point, Laura. We call it Taps at the Tower. It began in 2014 and it ended, it started 1 week and ran up until the evening of the 28th. June, which was the assassination of the Archduke and Sophie, which, you know, was the kindling which was struck that led to the cataclysm of World War I. So we now do this every year in the last week, essentially, of June. It's a 3-minute ceremony, same every year. 400, 500, 600 people come out for this very brief ceremony. And why? Because we wanted the opportunity for people to not have to commit an hour and a half or 2 hours like they would for Memorial Day ceremony, but come out for a 3-minute ceremony where they can begin perhaps with their neighbor or bring their children and begin to ask important questions about what happened then and why did this happen? And what are the values that matter? And so we read that inscription that you referenced, Laura, and we have just a couple of other elements. It's very brief, but the purpose of it is to seek to connect people to their current experience, that which happened 100 years ago. So this goes to your question, the significant challenge that we face, but it's totally a surmountable challenge, is to be able to help people find access to or ways of entry to understand World War I and its enduring impact. And the significant thing is that, the, you know, the world essentially came undone. When it was put back together, it didn't get put back together the same. And for the United States, it really changed the American experience. So there's many ways for us to access and give thought to World War I, what was happening around that time, and what was it, its enduring impact. So the good news is, I think that there are ways that that the audiences are very responsive to, so long as we seek to build those bridges between what happened then and why it happened, and then how do we find ourselves in the world that we've been living for the past 100 years. Memorialization helps us with that. It can provide a focal point then around which we begin that conversation.
Mm-hmm. It is, as the curator of education, it's a joy to be able to go back to our archive, to have that freedom to be able to tell the stories, to share that context. One of our questions already, and thank you, Kathleen McMahon, for that, I was talking about, is a question about Frank Buckles, which we can head into a little bit later on, but we've got the opportunity and some of those spaces to tell that. And we've got pictures of Buckles at our location, and then get to tell more about that story. I recognize that there is a tremendous challenge when you don't have a museum connected to the memorial. Now, Edwin, that is not only the case that there's not necessarily the museum. You all have done an amazing job of layering more context and interpretation on top of that. But you also had to take what was an existing space and some monuments there and update that. Can you speak more to the challenge of updating a memorial like Pershing Park?
Sure. And I usually start with a very, very rough paraphrase of Leo Tolstoy. And I say that every memorial in Washington is challenging in its own way. But this one seemed to have more layers of challenge than others. And I contrast this to, for those who have been to Washington, and if you've been to the Vietnam Veterans Memorial or the World War II Memorial, those memorials only had to be a memorial. They were built on, particularly in the case of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, it was built in a blank grassy area. It did not have to do too much to take into account its surroundings. It didn't have to serve any purpose other than to be a memorial. The Korean War Veterans Memorial, the World War II Memorial, very similar. World War I Memorial is off the mall, for a variety of reasons. And we located it in a place called Pershing Park, which already existed on Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington. Pershing Park had been, or that site had been selected in the 1960s as a site for a memorial to General Pershing. And my agency, the ABMC, led that effort. But then it became part of the redevelopment of Pennsylvania Avenue. And those planners wanted a site that had civic and recreational uses and wasn't just a memorial. And so as we'll see later, the Pershing Memorial, current Pershing Memorial, occupies one corner of that site, and the rest consists of other landscape elements somewhat unrelated to World War I commemoration. And so one challenge was to take a site that was a park that happened to have a memorial located within it, and how do we reframe that site so it is viewed primarily as a memorial, but a memorial that is located within a well-functioning, living, breathing urban park, and that people can enjoy as a park without being overwhelmed by the memorial feeling of it. So that was one challenge.
It needs to be somewhere where you can still sit and eat your lunch.
Exactly. And you know, we're gonna, as you'll see, we have a water feature there, a large pool of water. And people have asked, well, are you worried that people are going to come and throw coins in the water or take their shoes off and dangle their feet in the water? Won't that be disrespectful? My thought is, if they're doing that, that means they're there. And that's what I want. And then while they're dangling their feet, they can be looking at the sculpture and be thinking about the sculpture. And so I welcome that. So that was a challenge that we knew at the outset we'd have to take on. And that infused the design competition and the design process from day one. What I didn't anticipate was a second challenge, which is that we'd have to preserve as much of the existing park as we had to. And that's a whole other saga, but it was considered to be a significant work by a prominent mid-century American landscape architect. And so we thought at the beginning, we'd have pretty free license to redesign the whole site. We didn't. We had to work within the contours of the existing site. And the funny thing in the ways of these processes is that didn't turn out to be such a terrible thing. We were able to take advantage of some features of the site, work our memorial within them, and I think the end product is a good one. A third challenge is what we've touched on already, is how do you design a memorial to events that happened 100 years ago, about which viewers will not know very much, to honor veterans who are no longer with us? How do you incorporate all those values that we talked about a few minutes ago? You know, we talked to Laura, you touched on how those meanings change over time. I'm always struck when I think about the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, which of course is that massive black granite wall with the names of 58,000 Americans who died in the war. That means one thing to the parents, the spouses, the children, the comrades of those soldiers who knew them. And when they go to that memorial today, they can feel a very direct and immediate grief and memory of those individuals. 50 years from now, 75 years from now, what is that memorial going to mean? Those names are going to be much more abstract. The world, Vietnam will be part of our history, not part of our current collective experience. And so as we were designing the World War I memorial, we had that in mind. We are no longer honoring living veterans. We are no longer a place of grief or memory for the people who knew them. And so that affected the choices that we made. At the same time, we wanted a memorial that spoke, that in the design idiom, spoke to the era it was commemorating, but without, but being somehow modern at the same time. So when we look at the sculpture, you'll see that there's no bare-breasted figure of liberty. There's no allegorical angel presiding over the battlefield, anything that you would see in memorials 100 years ago. And then the fourth challenge, and Matt, you touched on this at the beginning when you talked about how in this country we don't do memorials from the top down. That wasn't just true 100 years ago, that's true today. The Congress, the executive branch, they don't have a program of, all right, we have just fought this conflict, now let's build our memorial. Every memorial I've talked about has been the result of private citizens or private organizations petitioning Congress for authorization to establish that memorial in the nation's capital. As Matt knows well, when Congress created the World War I Centennial Commission, you know, the commission is a federal agency given a mission by the Congress and given no money to execute that mission. And so we had to start out raising our own money. Likewise, the memorial has been funded primarily by private funds. In the way of Washington, all these memorials, some federal money winds up making its way into it in one way or another, but the bulk of it has been private fundraising. So that was the fourth challenge. If I'd known all that 12 years ago, I don't know if I would have taken this project on, but we took it one step at a time, and a lot of people put their time and energy into it, and it paid off.
And 12 years, I think, you know, that's really quite fantastic, isn't it? That was able to be, it is being accomplished within a comparatively short period. When you look at other memorials in DC, it's a many more years.
Well, and this particular project, Matt, is really shorter than that, because 12 years ago, we were talking about, you mentioned the local District of Columbia War Memorial that is on the mall. And back in 2008, we were talking about expanding that memorial so that we could have a spot on the wall. It wasn't until the commission was formed in 2013 that the commission said, all right, let's proceed at Pershing Park. So we got the authorizing legislation 6 years ago, and have a memorial that's almost done except for the sculpture. The Eisenhower Memorial, which just opened, that was 20 years in the making. And we did it in 6, and that's a pretty fast time for Washington, D.C.
What strikes me, Laura, is how different this is from so many other of the memorials in D.C. For all the reasons that Edwin has articulated, and I think that people will find it surprisingly experiential and a powerful experience when it's completed and they're able to experience the entire memorial park.
And that actually leads us to some good questions, which Edwin, I think perfectly tease you up to take us on a virtual tour. There was a question from Connie Ruzic. I hope I said your last name correctly. I'm interested in the memorial inscriptions, and I'd love to hear more about the inscriptions chosen for the National World War I Memorial in Washington, D.C. And an anonymous attendee asks, an anonymous attendee from Washington, D.C. would like to know when might that memorial open? And I can answer that last one as Edwin gets us ready to go on a virtual tour, which is sometime in 2021.
Well, and it's a little more, and I'll touch on both these questions. We had aimed to, if any of you have ever built a house or remodeled your house, you will understand me when I say there have been delays in the construction. We had hoped to open it, ideally, Armistice Day this year. That got pushed to December. But because of some COVID-related considerations, because of some weather, we lost a few days because of protests in Washington, because we are one block from the White House on Pennsylvania Avenue. And so, you know, all those factors, the main memorial site will be complete by around March 1, give or take. And we are going to have an opening ceremony April 16, when the weather's a bit nicer and some more of the vegetation has come in and it'll be blooming a bit. We just went through an exercise to see if we could grow poppies in a hothouse somewhere so that we could have blooming poppies in the ground on April 16th, but that proved not to be feasible. Poppies are a fragile flower, as you know, both hardy and fragile at the same time. Temperamental is the word I'm looking for. So we couldn't guarantee we'd have them grown and blooming by April 16th. The sculpture that we'll see in a minute, that's going to take another 3 years. That's going to be about a four-year sculpting process. And so it'll be complete in a few years. But the site will be open to the public April 16. So if you want me to switch over to the fly-through, let me share my screen and go find, where is it? Bear with me. Laura, I had it a minute ago.
You did. That's all right. That we are a gracious space as I was talking to the wrong camera for the first 60 seconds to 2 minutes.
That was a good side profile, Laura.
Wasn't it? Thanks.
It was.
Do you have it now, Laura?
Not yet. While you're working on that, I'll answer a question of Francis Grigsby, who said, why did the commission decide not to add to the present district memorial? And I would say that in part, there was some really good and hearty conversation about what the original intent of that memorial was, and that it was created by the people of the District of Columbia. And so that there was some hearty conversation on that. Now both Matt and Edwin can speak to that more after our virtual field trip.
Sure. So what we're looking at is a computer-generated rendering of the park design developed by our architects. And essentially they fed photographic images of the existing site and its surroundings, and then all of the various computer pages from the site, and stitched together this 3D image that we will do sort of a virtual reality tour through. And I'll pause it from time to time to talk to you about what you're looking at. But this vantage point right here is not quite right over the White House, but the White House is right at your back. And you're looking across 15th Street, and then moving up above out of the frame is Pennsylvania Avenue, which ultimately leads to the Capitol. So with that, here we go. So the image sort of pans around. And I'll stop it here. So here in the lower right corner, this is the existing Pershing Memorial. There's a statue of Pershing flanked by two walls, which you can sort of see here. The one on the bottom left is a little bit harder to see. One wall has a quotation from Pershing, and this wall right here has a fair amount of text talking about the accomplishments and achievements of the American Expeditionary Forces in World War I at a very sort of high level of military history. It's stirring enough in its language, but it doesn't get down into the blood and guts of it all, I would say. And it is about the AEF. It doesn't touch on the Navy. It doesn't touch on civilian service. Those were all elements we had in mind as we thought about this transforming this, which was transforming what was called the American Expeditionary Forces Memorial to a larger World War I memorial that covered not just the contributions of all the armed services, but the home front, the civilian population as well. So there are three main focal points to the memorial. You've got the Pershing precinct here in the bottom right. Here in the center, this round element, that used to be a visitor kiosk. That's been taken down. That's now what we call the Belvedere. It's raised up a little bit, so it gives out a view over this pool here toward the memorial sculpture. Along the top of that Belvedere will be about 9 interpretive panels that will talk about various aspects of the American experience of the war, not just the military history, but it will talk about the demographic diversity of the contributions of American society. It will talk about the legacy of the war in terms of its shape, of its impact on the post-war world, on American society after the war. It will talk about some of the key military history aspects. It will talk about, as we've touched on today, sort of the history of World War I commemoration in this country, including a mention of the National World War I Museum and Memorial in Kansas City will be acknowledged on that Belvedere. If you can see in the center of the Belvedere floor, a bit of a gold or bronze feature there, that is an enlargement of the Victory Medal that was awarded to all American servicemen who served on the Western Front. We took that to the foundry that is casting the original sculpture. I took the original die over to the UK. They did a computer scan of it, enlarged it, and recast it in bronze. So I think that'll be quite a neat feature. And then over here is the memorial sculpture being done by sculptor Saban Howard. We'll look at that more closely in just a minute. So as we continue around the site, I'll pause again. You can see how we plan to have poppies in the landscape. Those will be planted and then replanted every couple of years, so that hopefully every year, ideally around Memorial Day, there will be poppies in bloom. Here's the Pershing statue that I talked about. The rest of the landscape design is all pretty much original from the park, although we've changed some of the plantings. Now here, this pool of water was there in the original park. It was a ornamental pool in the summertime and actually operated as a skating rink in the wintertime. But the National Park Service, which owns the site, was very unenthusiastic about it continuing to be an ice skating rink. So we located the sculpture. This actually comes up out of the pool itself, as you'll see. And it's at the far end of this park. And we built this platform that you can walk out onto. So you can get up to within about 5 feet of the sculpture and really appreciate it close up. And this area right here in the middle is what we call a scrim. It is a very shallow, about an eighth of an inch basin of water that will be there during the summertime. It will be drained in the winter. And more importantly, it can be drained in the event, if there's going to be an event on the site. So you can take the water out of the scrim, put chairs all along this platform and hold ceremonial events or performances or what have you on that site. So that's a very distinctive feature of this. And so you can see that you're able to walk out onto it and come up. And this way you can appreciate the sculpture from a variety of perspectives. And we'll be coming back to this I was gonna walk through it here actually. So if we walk back, I'll sort of let me tell you the narrative of this. The sculpture is titled A Hero's Journey. And about halfway through the conception of it, the sculptor's wife, who's a novelist, pointed out to him that the narrative was taking the shape of the archetypal hero's journey, which appears in legend and myth across all cultures, across world history. And it tells the story of a recurring American soldier who shows up at various points in the sculpture as he departs for war, goes through the trial of combat, and ultimately returns home. And it's meant to operate on a second level as well in conveying in a somewhat allegorical way the American story of the war. And so each scene can be told on both of those levels. What you see here on the far left, the hero is with his wife and daughter as his daughter hands him his helmet as he is about to leave the home front and go to war. And in this next scene, his wife puts a restraining hand on his arm as if to hold him back from going off to war. And that's meant to reflect the American debate about neutrality, about whether to enter the war in the first place. And so there you see it operates on both those two levels. But you can't quite see in the shadow here. Here he's linked arm in arm with comrades as they answer to call to arms and they join the parade to war. This is a 38-figure sculpture, which gives us a lot of opportunity to reflect the diversity of the American Armed Forces at that time. This soldier, for instance, is an African-American, as is this one. And of course, 350,000 African-Americans served in the war, you know, ostensibly fighting for democratic freedoms overseas that they didn't enjoy fully here in the United States. One thing that you'll see as we go through this is the sculpture starts off very quietly and then begins to pick up speed and pick up velocity. And what is a very orderly parade here on the scene to the left starts to break down as the troops begin to get ready for battle. And then in the battle scene just becomes much more chaotic. And so we move along here. This is the central scene. This is the very central figure. And again, this is our hero again, leading troops into battle. I had told this sculptor, illustrate for me the famous battle cry from Belleau Wood from Marine Corps Gunnery Sergeant Dan Daly, who, according to legend, called to his men as they were about to charge across the wheat field into the forest, "Come on, you sons of bitches, do you want to live forever?" And I said, give that to me. And that was his depiction of that moment. And so here you see this is a much more turbulent scene. You've got this tangled mass of soldiers. They'll have a variety of facial expressions from all-out fury to fear as they come out of the trenches and into the fray. This figure here is a Native American. The models that Sabin has been using are of Eastern Europe descent, Southern European descent. There really will be a great diversity to this. And then as we come through the battle, we begin to see its cost. Here we have a pieta scene of a wounded or perhaps dying soldiers. This figure here, by the way, is our one opportunity to get the Navy in here. He'll have a Navy corpsman's insignia on his sleeve. You know, we chose not to try to be encyclopedic in this sculpture. And so people have said, well, do you have tanks? Do you have airplanes? Do you have artillery? And we chose not to try to incorporate every single aspect of the war in it. That wasn't the purpose. As we move forward, again, we see the cost of war. Here we're able to introduce the role of women on the battlefront. There are, I think, seven female figures in this sculpture, six or seven. This one is very much on the battlefront as opposed to others who are on the home front. Here is an overt reference to one of the technologies of the war, the gas mask, of course, and the soldier is holding his eyes as if he's been blinded. Another thing I asked the sculptor for was, we have all this left to right movement of the sculpture. All the figures are moving from left to right. Give me one figure that stops and stands and looks out at the viewer. And so, and I said, give me the 1,000-yard stare. And so this is our hero. He has passed through the trial of combat. He is beginning to recover. He stops here, he looks at the viewer. The viewer has the opportunity for a moment of communion to reflect on what it meant and what it was for and what it was cost. These helmets down here at his feet are meant to reflect the fallen without having something so somber and ponderous as a figure of a dead soldier. and see her. You have another nurse helping a soldier off the field. And then you see here how the parade starts to reform. And so just how at the beginning of the sculpture, the parade formed. Oh, let me go back. This always fades out on me too fast. Just as at the beginning of the sculpture, there was a formal parade that began to break down. Here you see the parade start to reform. First, there's a grouping of soldiers coming off the field. And then here is the victory parade home, holding the flag. This figure is looking back with pride at American accomplishment in the war. These figures, which include a woman, are not just returning home, but they're really stepping onto they represent the United States stepping onto the world stage at the beginning of the 20th century, or what we call the American century. And including a woman in this grouping reflects the new and changed role of women in American society. And you can't quite see because it starts to fade out and it might be hidden by the thumbnails on the Zoom presentation. But here the soldier is handing his helmet back to his daughter as he returns home. His daughter represents the greatest generation. And what you can't see is that the daughter looks into the helmet, and in the helmet she sees World War II, which will bring Americans back to Europe 20 years later. So that's the narrative of the sculpture. We think it's awfully powerful. And again, there's a lot of education built into this memorial in a lot of subtle ways that we're very proud with. So now the sculpture fades out and we resume the tour. There was a question about the McLeish quote. This is the back of the sculpture. And so you see the sculpture wall arises out of the water. It has water cascading down the front, which you'll see in a moment, and then water cascading down the whole length of this wall on the back. And in front of the water, these letters won't be carved into the stone, they'll be pinned to the stone, is an excerpt from the famous Archibald MacLeish poem, "The Dead Not Soldier," the Young Dead Soldiers Do Not Speak. And the selection that we've included, if I can call this up while I'm sharing my screen, is whether our lives and our deaths were for peace and a new hope or for nothing, we cannot say. It is you who must say this. They say, we leave you our deaths, give them their meaning. We were young, they say, we have died, remember us. And what's powerful about that inscription, and it touches on something we spoke about a little while ago, is it speaks not just to the veterans, but it speaks to the viewer. To redeem the sacrifice that they made and give them peace, give a meaning to their sacrifice. And MacLeish, of course, had been an Army artillery officer in the war, later on went on to become Librarian of Congress and be a three-time winner of the Pulitzer Prize. His brother Kenneth was a Navy pilot in the war, was shot down over Belgium and is buried at the American Cemetery in Flanders. Now, the other interesting thing about this, about the MacLeish quote, is we had the wrong quote. MacLeish had written an earlier version of that poem for internal government purposes at the beginning of World War II. And that's the version that I found that popped up on the Library of Congress website. And we've been using it for a couple of years until someone pointed out to me that when he published the poem in the early 1950s, he revised that last quatrain. And so at the last minute, we had to go back and put the published version, which I think was actually ultimately stronger than the one we've been using. But the lesson there is always hire a copy editor. And so now you can see how the sculpture wall integrates within the pool. You see how the water cascades down both on the back and in the front. And here you sort of, here's the Belvedere that I talked about. You can see how you can step into that and how there are interpretive panels along the top and that victory medallion in the center. Now, someone had asked a question about quotations, inscriptions, and there are five. There's one by General Pershing, which was already there. It's on one of the walls around the Pershing statue. And then there's the McLeish quote that I just quoted. This quotation here is from President Wilson, and it says, in effect, never before have men crossed the seas to a foreign land to fight for a foreign people for a cause they did not pretend was particularly their own, but knew was the cause of all humanity and mankind, which we thought very well expressed the American purpose in entering the war. And there was some, there were questions raised about whether or not to have an inscription from President Wilson, given the reconsideration of him that's ongoing right now, given the Black Lives Matter. And Black Lives Matter Plaza, which you've heard about, is just two blocks away from this memorial. But we thought it important. Wilson was our president. Wilson did articulate the reasons for American entry into the war. We thought it was essential to have an inscription from him. And then on these, let me come back here. These are some planter boxes. And inscribed on the front of two of these planters are inscriptions from two other Americans. One is from a nurse named Alta Mae Andrews, who in a letter to her mother wrote, in effect, if the war, if it has to be that this world must be embroiled in a war to end all wars, then I am glad that I too may play a part in it. And we thought that that spoke for all the elements of American society who might have been marginalized in one way or another, yet still chose to serve their country. And that applies to women, to African Americans, to immigrants, Native Americans, and so on. And then the other quote is from Willa Cather, from her World War I novel, One of Us. And it says simply, they were mortal, but they were unconquerable. And then here's a nighttime view. And there you have it.
Edwin, that's beautiful. I want to answer a couple of quick questions while I can. Gary Black, you asked about how are you spelling McLeish? I think you can find it on the website, ww1cc.org. But Edwin, do you know the answer to that?
How are we spelling
what? Articled McLeish, please.
Spell it, how are you spelling it?
Yes.
M-A-C-L-E-I-S-H.
All right, so Gary, if you've got further questions about that, then feel free to email our good friends at the World War I Centennial Commission or at the Doughboy Foundation. We've also had a couple of questions about Frank Buckles, and someone really wanted to make sure that I noted that Frank Buckles absolutely was a supporter of the National Memorial in Washington, D.C. We were so pleased and honored to have him visit and be so supportive of the memorial in Kansas City, but he absolutely testified at the age of 108 in front of the United States Congress to help promote and get a national memorial to World War I in Washington, D.C. So thank you for that comment as well. Question I am going to actually provide to both of you as I start to pull up some of our educational resources was actually provided to us from Facebook Live, and it is beautiful. It is a beautiful question. And thank you so much for that, Nikki Dean. Given the fact that our nation is experiencing a broadening gap between civilian and military experiences about warfare, what do you feel is the future of war memorials and museums to help communicate context and nuance of modern wars based on your experiences sharing the story of World War I? Both through a new DC memorial, but Matt, I'll start with you.
There is an argument that says, what is it about us that we are creating all these memorials to war in DC? If you were coming to from another country to the nation's capital, what you'll find is the memorialization of war. And that it's a compelling conversation to be had. I think it goes somewhat to the point being made. One of the things that we seek to do is to use the experience of war to talk about much broader themes, about why war happens, about the social impact of war, about immigration and how it contributes to and is an outcome of war. So whereas some people might think of the National World War I Museum and Memorial as a military museum, I view it as a social history museum that tells the story through the lens of World War I. So the opportunity for us, it seems to me, is to be able to talk about service and the common good and the impact of war and conflict and the horror of war and the incredibly difficult work of keeping the peace. That's the bigger conversation. And that's, it seems to me, as important conversation as honoring the memory of those whose lives were lost and who sacrificed for the country, for ideas bigger than themselves.
No, I think that's absolutely right, Matt. And we were trying to do much of the same thing, obviously on a different scale with a different degree of complexity than you all are doing out in Kansas City. Obviously, our focus is skewed a little more heavily toward the military history, to honoring those who served. But we were very, and I talked about this as I went through the sculpture and talked about the panels on the Belvedere, we very consciously wanted to reflect the entire national participation in the war, both in terms of across every element of society, but in terms of what was done on the home front. One of the Belvedere panels will be done about the war effort at home and how society organized itself for war and how citizens sacrificed and contributed to the war effort. We don't do that today. And I think one value of a memorial is to ask the question of why don't we and should we? And to participate in the conversation that way.
Excellent. And with that, I'm actually going to use that as our introduction quickly to just some of the resources that your national memorials to World War I have collaborated on since 2013. We have partnered with the United States World War I Centennial Commission, and I have a lot of deep gratitude for Drs. Libby O'Connell and Dr. Monique Seyfried, both commissioners who really wanted to spearhead and collaborate on creating educational resources that are great for the lifelong learner, but particularly focused and targeted to educators on the front lines in the classroom. So if you go to our website, theworldwar.org, you will have an opportunity to take a look at the education resource database. That right there shows just a portion of the incredible organizations that we have worked with since 2014 to commemorate the First World War. And we try to pull together the very best resources, including lesson plans, articles, curriculum, games, and interactives that can be used both in on-site classrooms and online. Every other month, we provide an education newsletter in partnership with the World War I Centennial Commission. Whether or not you are a teacher, there is topical information sent out that can enlighten on the enduring impact of World War I. We've also worked together to this summer produce a new website World War I Changed America. That tag is wwichangedus.org. That looks at exactly what Edwin was just speaking about and what we do throughout the main gallery as well. Looking at this, the different impacts in stories, particularly upon the United States. So you can see right there how we do look at and expand on that story of immigrants and immigration. With each of those topics, we have included a video, a podcast, primary source activity, and lesson plans. So again, whether or not you are a teacher or a lifelong learner, you will want visit this website. In particular, those videos are 7 minutes or less. They really are a great primer on each of those different topics. Again, I just encourage you to take a look at that website. when you're able, which could be right now because you can always multitask during a virtual event like this one. And I'm going to ask, actually, and there have been some other really great questions, but I'm so sorry, we have run out of time. I'm gonna ask you all both one last question, which is clearly, if you are watching this and if you are still watching this, you care about memorials and you care about memorialization. So in the year ahead, how can we engage with our national World War I memorials? Edwin, I'll start with you.
Well, come see it. I think, but beyond that, I mean, obviously we want people to come see it and appreciate it. And I say it, I really mean both of them. The one thing we haven't talked about is the same legislation that authorized the World War I Memorial in Washington also designated the Kansas City site as not just the National World War I Museum, but the National World War I Museum and Memorial. So we consider ourselves a pair. And we hope folks will visit both. But you know, going back to what, when people would ask me what was my objective, I always used to say, I want the dumb kid who comes to Washington on his high school trip to go to the World War I Memorial and realize, oh yeah, if there was a World War II, I guess there must have been a World War I. And what we really hope is that the memorial will inspire further education and further interest in the war. Because as we all know and have talked about at length, that it wasn't just a war that people did courageous things in. It transformed the world in this country for the next 100 years. And it touched every aspect. Sorry about that. It touched every aspect of American society. Same number goes to both phones. There we go. And you need to understand those things. And so we hope the memorials will not just be appreciated on their own terms, but that they'll inspire a lifetime of learning about the war.
Matt?
So Laura, when people are able to travel, you know, here we are dealing with a pandemic 102 years after the pandemic, which, you know, ravaged the world 100 years ago. When we're able to travel again, come and visit DC National Memorial and the National World War Museum Memorial in Kansas City. And all the time utilize the resources of the website. On our YouTube channel, we have hundreds of videos and you know, they're outstanding resource content and a really wonderful timeline for those who want to get a better understanding of the war and even just the architecture of the National World War I Museum and Memorial here in Kansas City as well. So visit us on the website, visit us in person, encourage others to do the same as well. You know, lest we forget is a phrase which we like to use at memorial events. That's something which we invite each of us to do. Do these things lest we forget.
And thank you all. In giving your time today, you are actively taking part in the memorialization of World War One. Share with those who you are around and join us online. Join us and think about us in both our organization and the World War One Centennial Commission in your thoughts on giving at the end of this year. But again, thanks for giving us your time. Thanks for giving us your thoughts. It's been a delight to be in conversation with you all. And Edwin, Matt, it's been a real delight to be in conversation with you both. Thank you so much for your time for this Lunch and Learn.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure, Laura. Thank you.